Now, let's take another look at the Piedmont computer simulation. Had a big tornado today, F5. They took the data from it, pumped it into a computer program they'd written, and they came up really with a lot of this streamlines. What was the wind doing? Horizontal tubes of vorticity being tilted into the vertical. Look at all that motion in there. Isn't it amazing you can do that with mathematics? Horizontal tubes tilted into the vertical, stretched, and the winds increase. Now let's look at a more simple presentation on this.
What in the world do we have here? Well, we have a very large thunderstorm. It's a little bit narrow, and it's rotating, and there's the updraft. And you see that tube? Well, that's caused by differing wind speeds and wind directions in the lower levels. Let's say at 3,000 feet, the wind is 30 miles an hour. And let's say at 6,000 feet, it's 60 miles an hour. So you can just put a pencil down on the desk there and roll it, because when the wind is stronger at the top than it is at the bottom of that tube, it will rotate. So it kind of floats along through the atmosphere. It gets close to the thunderstorm, gets caught in the updraft and goes up, and that can become part of a tornado. How does that work? Well, it's kind of fascinating. Let me give you an example here. Ice skater. Ice skater spinning with their arms out. Certain speed, brings arms in, spins faster. This tube is tilted into the vertical, and as it goes up, it's stretched. And as you stretch it, and you saw all this mathematically, as you stretch it, the diameter becomes less. And so what does it try to do? It tries to conserve its speed, so the speed increases. And sometimes you'll just have a total rotating thunderstorm that comes to the ground. Sometimes you'll have many of these horizontal rotating tubes of vorticity, we call it, come into the storm, get tilted in the vertical, get stretched, and become a part of the thunderstorm. Like I said, this is an absolutely fascinating world. Visually, the first indication of a tornado to come may be a wall cloud. A wall cloud is a lowering, usually in a rain-free area, and for it to be dangerous, it must be rotating. Now, sometimes it's really difficult to tell if they're rotating when you're observing them. You know, it may produce no tornadoes, it may produce a small tornado, it may produce more than one medium-sized tornado, it may produce a large one, it might produce a multi-vortex, or just a huge tornado. Most of them spin counterclockwise, but sometimes they spin the other way. So keep that in mind. There's a lot of ifs, ands, and buts in meteorology. Let's check out some wall clouds now. Look at these images. And lowering in a rain-free area. Now, sometimes I have to tell you, they do come in the rain. Alrighty? There's another one, rain-free area, lightning off the left. It's lowering. What's happening if you're standing there, the wind is coming from past your back, into your back, flowing into that storm, into that wall cloud. Remember that little tube we had going up? That's what's happening. Air is flowing into it. Another one a little closer, very close to the ground. The more moisture in the atmosphere, the closer the wall cloud will be to the ground. And normally you can look at a wall cloud like this and you'll be about 95% accurate if you say there's going to be a tornado. Now this is the monster storm, May 31st, 2013, Canadian County. That's the base of the thunderstorm. It's over you. Then there's this titanic-sized wall cloud that's rotating in the distance. The winds inside the storm around that updraft we were talking about are rotating violently at this point. And here's a night shot for you. This could be a wall cloud. It could be just an updraft region, because that air starts up, it cools and it condenses and it forms a cloud. So it may just be updraft, might be a wall cloud. And observing a lot of times at night, you can make mistakes along those lines. Now this, you see a big corkscrew thunderstorm covering the right-hand half of the page. And on the left, you see what appears to be this huge area of air and clouds moving into it. And that's exactly what's happening. The entire thunderstorm is rotating, and that huge area there is a large area of moisture and clouds and high-speed winds, a feeder band moving into the storm. Now there's one. On this particular day, it's up near Cherokee, Oklahoma. The entire storm is rotating. It's rotating above your head, and there's one funnel getting ready to come down. By the way, a funnel is a tornado not touching the ground. When a funnel touches the ground, it becomes a tornado. There's other ones hanging down and finally produce some significant tornadoes that day. And here's one, pretty obvious if you're out there, and really if you're out there and taking this picture, you're in the wrong position. A big lowering, big rotation. Keep in mind the rotation is just not with the tornado and the wall cloud. It extends all the way up to the thunderstorm. And if it's really large like that Canadian County tornado, it can put down tornadoes in different locations. Tornadoes sometimes come from wall clouds, sometimes they don't. Sometimes wall clouds produce no tornadoes. But let's look at a few tornadoes that we've had that come from generally wall clouds. It's probably like a lot of tornadoes in the plains and elsewhere, not very big, not on the ground too long, and they don't do too much. Here's another one. Now, by the way, if that funnel cloud, looks like a funnel cloud, is two-thirds of the way to the ground, it's probably on the ground, you just can't see it. So what you do, you look for the dirt and the debris and the dust, all that being kicked up by it. This is just classic. See the wall cloud up above? From it comes a tornado. Now sometimes, you know, they go through stages. They start little babies and they grow up. They get really big and mean sometimes. This one is pretty well formed, fairly strong, with tornado being generated in part by the wall cloud. Aerial shot, just show you, we have, you know, you get trapped and say, well, tornadoes look this way and do this way. These were two tornadoes side by side. Now here's a tornado in western Oklahoma. As I recall, it was an F4. And you notice if you're facing this tornado, it in fact is moving from your left to your right, but there's no rain or hail. So what happens as a thunderstorm approaches that has severe weather, possibly a tornado, the wind blows, it rains, it hails, and many, many times it stops raining and it stops hailing. Here's a big one. There's no precipitation close to this storm. This thing was at least 200 miles per hour, most likely stronger, down there in Chickasha, Oklahoma. Huge, huge tornado, May 3rd, 99. Huge wall cloud, entire thunderstorm is rotating. And this comes in from May 20th, 2013, in the Moore area. And you see kind of the clear area back to the left there. And I'll just tell you what that's caused by. That's caused by what we call the rear flank downdraft. It just comes down the backside of the storm, wraps around the storm, and actually we think helps increase the intensity of the tornado. But major tornado, very large, and like I said, huge wall cloud, entire thunderstorm rotating. And this is what we call the monster tornado. This is in Canadian County. It ended up being 2.6 miles across, and you want to talk about the thunderstorm rotating. It was absolutely horrendous what was going on with this storm. Extreme wind speeds and capable of extreme damage, extreme winds, all the things that come with a monster tornado. And you notice it's not raining, it's not hailing right at this location. How does hail stay in the air? Look at this picture. It's a huge piece of hail, and usually it's smaller than that. But how does it stay up there? Updraft, vertical wind, sometimes over 100 miles per hour, keeps that hail in the air. And when it gets heavy enough to fall out, that's exactly what happens. Now, let's take a look at this graphic. It will show updraft wind speed versus hail size when it's going to fall out. So really fascinating there. But what happens with hail? Let's say a little raindrop gets thrown up through that thunderstorm. It goes way up there. It goes in that area that's below freezing, and it freezes. But around that area, as I mentioned, there is what we call supercooled water. It's below freezing, but it's not solid. It's liquid. And it collects in that little piece of ice. It goes on up and then it comes back down, overcomes the updraft. And it gets thrown again. In the storm, it's thrown up and down and up and down. And every time it goes through that zone of super cool water, that water that is below freezing, ice just collects on it. Boom, 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 boom. Finally, it becomes heavy enough to overcome the updraft. Pretty simple stuff, really. Took a lot of people to figure that out. Let's take a look at a vertical schematic of a full-blown supercell. You have the air flowing in there in the lower right, kind of coming in, it's being pulled into the Mezzo Cyclone. The Mezzo Cyclone is just a low pressure inside this thunderstorm that rotates and goes up. Also helps to produce the wall cloud. Sometimes a tornado comes from that, but the moist air from the Gulf of Mexico is coming in. On the right, you have what we call the forward flank downdraft, because you'll be watching that storm and suddenly you get hit with air, strong winds from the west, and other directions too, but that flows out. There's your rotating mesocyclone. Goes all the way to the top of the storm. It's really strong. Like I said, it's warmer than the surrounding air. And it's the overshooting top. It's the bubble we looked at on that satellite photograph earlier. So that bubbles up through there. And there's your, where it says upper level winds. That is generally 40 to 60,000 feet above that. And that's that anvil made out of ice crystals. And we have mid-level winds coming in from the west. Sometimes they'll wrap in the mesocyclone, help intensify it. Other times they'll come down the backside of the thunderstorm as a rear flank downdraft and almost tip your car over. This is just an excellent, excellent presentation on a, we just call it a cross-section of a supercell thunderstorm.